Sample size is essentially the number of research participants or volunteers that you need to participate in your study. And I use that terminology because, first of all, it's not always right to refer to them as patients. If you're doing a survey on totally healthy people, they're not patients. Remember, patients comes from the Greek word meaning to suffer. Those people aren't suffering. You may just want to interview people who are out there in the wider community as to why they get a flu vaccine or not. Those people aren't sick. They're not patients. So, and the second thing is, for these research studies, people are really, you have to rely on the altruism of folks who sign up to volunteer to be a participant in the study. So always keep in mind that these people are research volunteers. They're helping you out by being in the study. So many variables have what's called a normal distribution, or the famous bell-shaped curve that we all learned about in grade school when we were getting A's, B's, C's, and D's. So what that means is that many data falls onto this kind of bell-shaped curve where 95% of the data is in the middle, and there's 2.5% of the data on what's called the tails of this curve. So if I took, for instance, the height of people in this room, there would be an average height, and then there would be some distribution. So if Danny DeVito walks in and Shaquille O'Neal walks in, what's going to happen is this curve is going to get broader because we're going to have people on one end and another person on way far on the other end. So keep that in mind when we talk about homogeneity in the data. So, but what I've done here is I just, so that middle part of the curve is what's called two standard deviations from the mean. The mean is right down the middle at the top of that bell. So, but what I've done here is this is a descriptive study. I'm only looking at one curve. But what we want to do in a clinical trial that's analytical, comparing one group to another, is we want to do this. We want to compare one group to another group. So, but the clinical trials, what they do is they compare average effects in groups of research participants who are administered an intervention to another group of people who don't get the intervention. So let's look at this example here. Suppose we have two groups, and if you look down at the bottom, the one group is centered around 50, and the other group is centered around 0, down at the bottom of that, if I can actually show this. Right here, this is the one mean, and here's the center of this bell-shaped curve is at 50 on the other one. So there's only 12 people per group in here, and the standard deviation, which is the width of the bottom of this bell-shaped curve, is 60. And the reason that this curve is shaped this way is because we have only 12 people in the group. Now what happens if we, so what we want to do, what does statistically significant actually mean? So what statistically significant means is, and the p-value of 0.05 means we want this little red tail of the one group to actually fall out, the mean of this curve, to exclude all of this curve except for that little 2.5% red tail on that end. So how do we get there? The first thing I want to show you is, look at this big overlap between these curves, right? So getting a p-value of 0.05, which means there's 2.5% on this end and 2.5% on this end, doesn't mean these two curves don't overlap. They overlap a lot. It just means they don't overlap as so much that we only have this little teeny tail overlapping the mean of this group. So what happens then if we go from 12 patients and increase the number of people to 24? Can you see the difference in the shape of these curves? The curves get taller and narrower because the standard deviation is now smaller. So by increasing the number of people in the study, the variability in these measures goes down. This is only accounting for random chance and random variability. So if I was measuring height, but I used a ruler for this group that was off by 2 inches, but I used a ruler for this group that was completely accurate, that is a systematic bias in the study. This will tell me nothing about that. This is only a measure of random variability, not a measure of bias. So random variability means it's occurring equally in both groups. So again, notice there's a good deal of overlap here. We're just excluding this little tail down at the bottom. So finally, if we increase this to 48 people per group, look at this, there's hardly any overlap at all between these things. Notice the mean doesn't budge. It's still 50 and it's still 0, centered around exactly the same place. But by increasing the sample size, you have managed to decrease the variability or the standard deviation between these two curves. You haven't done anything else. Haven't changed what you're measuring, haven't changed the patient population, nothing. You've just increased the sample size. But this is what people don't want to do. They want to do a smaller study. So how do we then decrease this variability without doing this, without putting more people into the study? So that then requires some understanding of what goes into sample size. Do not sweat this. You're going to get whole lectures on this stuff. This is just toe-in-the-water time to try to get some basic understanding of this to understand efficiency of trials. So a sample size is based on really four parameters or ingredients. And there are two types of error in clinical trials. The one is called type 1 error. Fancy schmancy word for saying you conclude something works when it doesn't. A false positive result. A type 2 error is actually you concluding that something doesn't work when in fact it does. A false negative error. The term power, which is overused tremendously, a la my namesake, is actually 1 minus the type 2 error. So type 1 error is usually that 0.05. That's where the p-value of 0.05 comes from. So a type 1 error means you would make a mistake and conclude a new drug was effective 5 times out of 100 or 1 time out of 20. So, and again, that 0.05 comes from that 2.5% tail on either side of that curve. The type 2 error is usually set at 10 or 20%. And since power is the ability to detect a difference when a difference exists, it means power is 1 minus that. So a trial with a type 2 error of 10 or 20% has a power of 80 or 90%. By the way, as an aside, you will hear more about this, there is no role for talking about these after a study is over. So these are only probabilities that occur before the study is done. So, for instance, you do a study and you expect to find that drug A is 10% better than drug B. It comes out that the results show drug A is 2% better than drug B, but you can't show a difference between them because that difference was so small. So what people will say after the study is, that study was underpowered. No, it wasn't. It was not. You got the effect size wrong to begin with. That's the problem. It was not underpowered. So it's kind of like when, you know, the Ravens are, what, 1-5 this year? They've only won one game all year. That was not the prediction before the year started, right? They were supposed to actually do pretty well, and now they've only won one game out of six. Well, you can talk about, well, if they had this guy wasn't hurt, and if they only had this one play that didn't go south. I love when sportscasters do this. But that's why you play the game. Those things did happen, and they did lose. That's the way it is. So talking about stuff that could have happened after a study is over is irrelevant. So there is a whole literature on the overuse of the term underpowered. And what people mean by that, well, is that if only I had done a bigger study, I would have detected a difference. And for reasons you'll hear about later, that is false. And that is because these numbers don't stay where they are. So there's something I showed you in these graphs that never happens in real life, right? When I did this and I increased the sample size, the 50 stayed at 50 and the 0 stayed at 0. That doesn't happen. Anybody want to know what phenomenon that is? You guys know, you've heard this. It's called regression to the mean. And what happens is, as the sample size gets bigger, these numbers are going to move closer to their true values. So, in other words, I think what the average... what the average male height in the United States is 5'9", and I think the average female height is 5'4", if I'm correct on that, right? So suppose we did the average in this room and it came out to be 6 feet for men and 5'2" for women. The more men and women we put into this room, what's going to happen? It's going to move towards the population mean. It is not going to stay at 6 feet, and it's not going to stay at 5'2". It's going to move towards where the true average actually is. So when people say their study is underpowered, they think that somebody came by and poured cement on this 50 and poured cement on this 0, and they can't move. And that what I showed you here, which is that the curves will just squeeze in around each other, that that actually happens in real life. This, folks, is a fictional example. I was only trying to show you the issue with standard deviation and try not to move too many things on the graph. But that doesn't happen because of regression to the mean. The other two components of sample size are the variability in the data, which is called standard deviation, and finally, the treatment difference, the difference between the test group and the control group. The bigger that difference is, the less number of people you need to actually show that. That's sometimes also called the effect size, or it can be called the delta as well. So here's the two things you're looking at. Variability in the data is the width of this curve, and the treatment effect size is the difference between the means of the two curves. By making these curves further apart and increasing the effect size, you can have a smaller sample size. By making the base of this narrower, by decreasing variability, you can have a smaller sample size.